So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Elizabeth Moody from Pandora.
Thank you.
So in preparation for this today, Elizabeth and I had a long conversation which exceeded the amount of time that we have to talk here. But I really want to give you a little bit of a background about Elizabeth and where she came from and how she started in the business. I think it's so important for us to understand the genesis of people that are in the top level of their fields today, especially for some of the people in the room that are making their way through this industry. So could you give us a little bit about your background?
And sure. I actually am from New York, from the East Coast, so it's nice to be back and bring the California weather with me. I started as a lawyer at a big law firm, Paul Weiss, New York City, representing the NMPA, doing a lot of the early digital deals, I worked on the NMPA-RIAA settlement when I was a first year out of law school, and quickly spent about 7 years doing that, and then I went over to work on sort of in the other side, representing a lot of the digital services, working with Fred Davis and his firm, with someone over here in the room. I worked with a lot of digital music startups, most of which are not around anymore. Some of them are. One of them just went public. And then in 2010, I moved over to the West Coast to work on lead up music partnerships at YouTube. Tried to leave music for a few years and worked on over the top television, and then Pandora found me about 3.5 years ago. So that's sort of my career trajectory, I think.
So why did you move through these different DSPs? What was the reason for it?
Part of the reason I went over to work with DSPs is I found that there wasn't a lot of collaboration between the music industry and publishers and the DSPs. So I thought it might be helpful to have someone who had seen sort of the publishing perspective to work on the sort of on the other side of the table. So, for example, when I went to YouTube, the first thing I did was settle the lawsuit that they had with the NMPA and the Harry Fox Agency and try to work through a operational agreement, and that was pretty successful. I think they're still using it today. So I think I like to think of myself as somebody that can think a little bit outside the box, and I'm a deal maker and a negotiator, but it's more about putting something that may be a little bit non-traditional together. So we have to think through what works for both the music industry and the digital services.
Sure. I mean, I think the industry was stagnant for a period of time because we didn't know which direction to make a deal, and it took some of the leadership at the NMPA to help get us to that place where we were able to make these deals for the independents as well as the majors.
Yep.
But I think we're all in the business of wanting to make money and figure out what's happening. So in your experience, what does it take to get that across the line, to get everybody on the same page?
I don't know if there's always going to be instances where we're not all on the same page. Well, maybe. I shouldn't say always, because let's hope in the future we find a place where we are. I think what was frustrating to me, probably for the first 5 to 7 years I was doing this, is that the industry was fighting the concept of digital distribution. So I'd go walk into the labels or the publishers and they'd say, how much money can you give us today? It was a little bit of a short-term, short-sighted, instead of looking through the business model in the long term. And that's changed significantly over the past 5 years or so. We're now, I think, we've all accepted this is the future of music. It's been an interesting transition because it's a very different way of distributing royalties, and songwriters in particular are feeling the brunt of it because it feels like there's not a lot of money. And I think what we need to do is work together to make sure that we're fixing things like data and transparency that we talk about all the time, but it's still a massive issue. And you know, maybe it's going to mean a little bit of restructuring of all of the businesses so that as distribution becomes a little bit more efficient, we may not need all of the overhead we have, and therefore there could be more money for songwriters. I do think that there's a path to making it to a good royalty distribution, to actually making a lot of money like there was in the music industry heyday. We're starting to see it coming back. I don't think it's a lost cause. I think we need to work together, though.
Right. Well, that's a perfect lead-in to the legislation that's on the table. And how do you think that's going to help us in the long run?
I think the best thing about that is the process for solving some of the data issues. A lot of the digital services like Pandora, I mean, we're in an interesting position because our business is struggling and we don't have a ton of money to start, you know, funding on behalf of the industry a lot of databases and, you know, maybe a little bit different position than an Apple or Google or Amazon that may have other businesses out there that they can use to fund it. But I think that the nice thing is we won't have to be so nervous about legal liability. We may want to go into this, but Pandora has taken a different perspective on licensing publishing, but it's been challenging. We're trying to do it the right way and making sure that we actually have licensed and matched all of the compositions that we're streaming, but it's quite complicated to do that because we've got competitors out there who just play everything, and it makes it a lot harder. So with the new legislation, we won't have to worry so much about that. I do think we've got a pretty good solution in place right now, but I think the benefit of the legislation is it will put everyone in all of the DSPs on a equal playing field.
Well, how much of Pandora's business is still based on algorithm as compared to what, you know, personal choice?
Actually, Pandora's, the way that we decide to serve up a song as part of the radio, it's always been a mix of both human curation and algorithm. I'm not sure that a lot of that kind of gets lost on the public, but we've got a strong team of curators in-house that will, now they're creating playlists, but they will, you know, pick and choose the music along with the algorithm. What happens when we decide to put tracks into our live stream is when we ingest music, every single song, for the most part, gets analyzed and listened to by our musicologists. We've got music scientists who listen to every song, analyze it, and categorize it based on, you know, different elements that they've identified. And that's a way that we can then decide, gosh, if you like this jazz song, you might actually like this new pop song that sounds quite similar. And we would not have necessarily known that just from human intervention. But the way that the ear and the mind works, we might be able to tell from identifying that through the algorithm. So it's a combination of both.
Right. So what do you think is next for Pandora? I mean, there's been a lot of press about the debt that Pandora has and then the relationship with Sirius and the new family plan pricing. What do you think is going to happen?
I think we're in a very similar position to all the other pure play services. And I think the Spotify's IPO was actually very good for us because it made a lot of our investors and other investors realize that our business model is actually one where we have a future and can make money. We sell better than any other music service on our ad-supported tier. We have a very strong advertising business. We're doing a decent job right now of driving subscribers as well. The models that we have worked out with the labels and the publishers allow us to have three individual businesses that can earn money on their own. I think we'll be doing much better, and you'll see a lot of changes by the end of this year on the music side. You know, we went through some leadership changes. There's been a lot of negative press about Sirius investing in us. They own 18%, so they're not by any means owners. But it's been a nice collaborative relationship with them, actually.
And the new ad business you just bought, that?
AdsWiz was an acquisition to allow us to make sure that we can maintain our lead in audio advertising. it was interesting when I came to Pandora 3.5 years ago, I was really surprised at the level of the CPMs we were garnering just from audio ads. And a lot of that was because we were doing it through the old-fashioned method of using people to sell, just like traditional terrestrial radio. I mean, a lot of folks compare us with other DSPs, but the truth is our primary competitor right now is still terrestrial radio. And that's an area where we're aligned, I think, with the whole music industry, because we are paying out a lot more money than terrestrial radio does. So in the size of the terrestrial radio business, the advertising business is more than 10 times the size of the digital music business. So there's a lot of potential for Pandora in the future if we can pull in a lot of listeners from terrestrial radio. Most of the middle part of this country is still listening to terrestrial radio. And we hear even from the record labels that most of our competitors' demographics are more in the 18 to 35-year-old kids on the East and West Coast. So if you look at Pandora's demographics, we have that demographic as well, but we are more widely spread across the country. That's part of the reason I think that country and Hispanic and Latin music is so popular on Pandora.
So we're in a women's club, so it's only appropriate that I ask you what challenges you may have had in your career balancing children and marriage, life in general, mm-hmm. to get where you are. I mean, you're obviously traveled across the country to be here. Thank you very much. And
yeah, I guess I'm in the same position as a lot of women. I'm a single mom with two kids. I've got a 10-year-old and a 12-year-old. My 10-year-old graduated from fifth grade last week and gave a speech in front of the whole school. So I'm definitely splitting my time between work and home life all the time. But sometimes I feel like I can't do it all. And sometimes I feel like I think a lot of working moms do, that I have the best of both worlds and I'm very lucky. It's not easy, but I think actually being a mom has made me a better leader and made me a better manager. Some of my teams in the room say they might disagree with me, I don't know. But it helps me, I think. I think it helps you identify every individual and their unique skills and attributes. Every single person has capabilities to do different things, and seeing that in your own children makes you realize that everybody's kind of like that. So I don't know that I've had a lot of sort of the challenges that are facing that are in the press. I think they're sort of the more typical day-to-day challenges that a lot of women face. It's fun though.
And I think across the board, being a parent is a challenge for everyone, regardless of male or female. Balancing family has always been an issue.
Yep.
Any career.
Yep.
So I'm going to give 5 minutes if anybody has any questions.